So, do you see my screen? Okay, good. Thank you very much for the introduction. I'm going to talk about electrode manufacturing. On the way to complete batteries or cells, the electrodes are really the components who govern and also limit the performance of batteries. On the way from materials to complete cells, this is a very important step. And for electrode manufacturing, we normally start with mixing process, mixing the active material with binder and some carbon blacks. Then we have the coating of the electrodes to the current collector, a drying step, and then at last a densification step, calandering. And then from the electrodes, we are going to cell assembling, slitting, stacking, winding, contacting, housing, and formation. And all these processes have to be optimized to get the best performance of the cell, but also to get a better carbon dioxide footprint for the manufacturing. And what we can do for electrode manufacturing is first going to electrodes with very high mass loadings or thicker electrodes in order to reduce the amount of passive materials and also to reduce the process steps. We can replace electrode manufacturing steps, for example, for the cathode by avoiding toxic solvents like NMP and work on aqueous coating for cathode. Another opportunity is going from solvent-based manufacturing to extrusion or complete dry coating. And of course, always important is the reduction of the energy which is consumed during the drying process. And for the cell assembling, the main point is to reduce the scrap by inline inspection and data processing, by reducing dry room space, working in micro environments, and by optimizing the complete energy management. This is also true for the formation process, where we should regain the energy from formation during this time. So if we are looking on the electrodes, state of the art are electrodes in the order of 4 milliampere hour per square centimeter areal capacity. So, and if it would be possible to use electrodes with much higher loadings, for example, 8 milliampere per square centimeter, it would be possible to increase the energy density of the complete cell by saving materials costs. We could save separators, current collectors, and so on. But it would be also possible to save process costs. What are the challenges for going to more thick electrodes? Normally, if the area capacity of the coating is increased, the adhesion to the current collector is decreased, and very often you end up with this wrinkled electrodes. So the first step is to develop a scalable roll-to-roll process with good product quality and without scrap. The second point is that, of course, for the thick electrodes, there are some transport problems inside the electrodes, which leads to very low rate capability and limited kinetics, and so a loss of power. And the question is it possible to increase the kinetics by structuring the electrodes? And what we have used is a coupled approach of predictive simulation and experimental process research. And to combine modeling and simulation, not here in ZSW, but from the groups of Arnulf Latz at DLR and the group of Volker Schmidt here at the University of Ulm, to determine or predict the an optimized structure for thick electrodes. And then we try to adjust the electrode manufacturing process for this electrode. At the beginning, the first step for electrode preparation is the mixing process, the dispersion process. And this dispersion process has a significant influence on the quality of the electrodes. There are many ways to prepare the slurry and slurries, and here I will introduce two different ways. One way is to have a dry mixing of carbon black, the active material, and the binder, and then kneading and mixing in NMP, you can see here on the left side. And even with different parameters, it always led to wrinkled electrodes, not very homogeneous electrodes. On the other hand, it's possible to start with a binder solution and make a dispersion of carbon black and active material mixing with the binder. And by optimizing this process, very nice roll-to-roll process has been developed with very good quality. The question is, what is the difference between this mixing procedures? And the difference is the rheology of the mixing process. On the on the left side, we start with a very high viscosity and have more or less a procedure with a very high shear stress. And on the right hand, starting with the binder solution, we start with a low viscosity and a very low shear stress. At the end, we more or less need similar viscosities for the end product to go to the coating process. If we have a more detailed look in the resulting electrodes from either from tomography or from image analysis. In image analysis, we followed the fluorine signal from the PVDF binder. And what you can see here is the distance from the separator. Here we are at the separator site. Here we are at the current collector site. And what you can see here is that the carbon binder domains are not not distributed homogeneously, and there is a much larger gradient for the mixing process with high shear stress compared to the mixing process with low shear stress. For both formulation, the carbon binder domain is not distributed homogeneously along the thickness of the electrode. And from calculations and modeling done in Arnulf Lutz group, the tomography is made by the University of Ulm. It's clear that there is different distribution also from lithium, different transport of lithium inside the electrodes, and they predicted. And you can see that here that there is a very good agreement between the modeling and experimental results, and they predicted that it's possible by using an optimum configuration of the electrodes to increase the rate capability of the electrodes significantly. The prediction of the modeling is that it's possible to optimize the electrode structure for thick electrodes and to increase the 1C capacity by a factor of 3 by optimizing carbon binder distribution. And for this, we need exactly the inverse distribution of the carbon binder domains. And then the question is, how can we achieve this? We tried different arrangements. First arrangement was to use active materials with two different particle sizes and to use a successive two-layer coating. It's known from literature that smaller particles show faster kinetics than larger ones, and also known from literature, from studies in literature, that the crack-free thickness of electrodes is limited by the particle size. And therefore the question was, what happens if we combine materials with different particle sizes and to have an arrangement of two moderately thick layers? Is it possible to improve the overall kinetics by this? There are other simulations and modelings in the literature which also predicted that it's possible by choosing the right right variation of electrode porosities and active materials to increase the capacity and the kinetics of the electrodes. This is also done for electrodes with two different layers from Ulrike Krever's group. And we started successive two-layer coating with two different materials. You can see here the materials were different in the particle size. And what you can see here are the electrochemical curves of pure electrodes from small particles, large particles, and a homogeneous mixture of this two materials. And in this case, there is no big difference between the different electrodes. But if we make two layer coatings, in principle, there are two possibilities. One possibility is to have the smaller particles near the current collector, or the smaller particles near the separator. And you can see here that this makes a big difference for the electrochemical electrochemical curve. The kinetics is decreased if the small particles or the layer with a smaller porosity is near the current collector. And for the opposite arrangement, we see that the rate capability is increased, and also the energy density of the electrodes at a specific current is significantly increased. So this means there is a gain of energy density at high currents without loss of capacity at low currents by making an hierarchical arrangement of different particles. The other approach was to change the carbon binder domain by using a simultaneous two layer slot die coating. In this case, we have used two different slurries. This distribution of the carbon binder domain has a very strong impact on the kinetics, which has been shown before and which was also shown by modeling. And the normal phenomenon is that for thicker electrodes, there is always a binder migration to the top of the electrodes during the drying process. And the question is, how can we get a more homogeneous distribution of the carbon binder domain, or is it possible to get even the optimum distribution. We use two different slurries. One slurry with a higher amount of binder, and another slurry with a lower amount of binder. And then we made a first layer with a higher amount of binder, and on top, a layer with a smaller amount of binder. This has also been described in literature before for cathode materials, but here for not really for thick electrodes, not for electrodes with high loadings, and has also been described for water-based anodes. In this case, the task was to increase the drying rate. So the results were ultra-thick electrodes with a loading of 50 milligram per square centimeter of active material, cathode material, NMC 622, and 8 milliampere hour per square centimeter. There's a very complex correlation between the different parameters for the slurry, for the individual formulation influences the behavior during the dispersion process, and of course also the rheological properties of the slurry. And therefore, this slurry development and also the development of the electrode production process has to be adapted to the different rheologies and to the different formulations. The adhesion to the current collector is decreased by increasing the amount of binder near the collector. This is something we do not really understand at the moment, but at the end, we were able to really get an inverse configuration of the carbon binder domain, and you can see here from the electrochemical result that this has a very strong effect on the rate capability, and this can be increased also by adapting the drying process. It's possible to use higher drying rates without getting an increase of the binder migration, which also has a beneficial effect on the production costs. And from the synchrotron tomography and the image analysis of the EDX, it has been shown that it was really successful to get another binder gradient, and the electrochemical results fit perfectly to what has been predicted from the simulation and modeling. There's a significant increase of the rate capability by the two-layer coating and also an adapted carbon binder distribution as predicted. For me, I'm working more on the experimental side, but for us, this was a really very nice example that simulation can also predict something, not only coming to results you are already knowing. So this predicted microstructure from simulation has really led to the experimental predicted experimental behavior, and there's an excellent agreement between the electrochemical measurements and the simulation, which is a very good example that a simulation can really help to better understand the effects going on in the electrodes, leads to a deeper understanding of the structure of the electrode. What has to be considered for very often the question is this not a very expensive process? What's necessary is a double mixing two different mixers and two different slurries. The slurries have to be adjusted. The drying of the electrodes can be much faster compared to a single layer coating, and an additional investment is that you need a specific slot die for this. So the next topic is the aqueous processing of a nickel-rich cathode material. I think you all know that a layered oxide, nickel-rich layered oxide, are normally processed with PVDF as binder in a process solvent N-methylpyrrolidone, which is a very toxic solvent. It is under reach in the European community. It's expensive for all the NMP has to be recovered from the coating process. And therefore, it would be very beneficial if it would be possible to replace the PVDF binder system by an aqueous binder system, and to use fluorine-free binders. Also better sustainability, lower drying temperature. But I think that the most important point for using aqueous binders for cathode is that this fluorine-free binders are really a very big problem for recycling electrodes and recycling cells. Every thermal process is very difficult with fluorine, and therefore it would be very nice to have the electrodes which are completely fluorine free, also which do not contain fluorinated binders for recycling. But of course, there are a lot of challenges and limitations. Normally, the cycling behavior looks like this. In yellow, you see a normal NCM811 process, this PVDF as binder, and this is an electrode with an aqueous binder, which shows quite significant capacity loss during cycling. We have lithium leaching from the active material. We have corrosion of the aluminium collector. And therefore, the question is, how can we process even NMCs with very high nickel content with aqueous binder? One problem is the aluminium corrosion of the aluminium foil. Normally, this NCM811 dissolved in water give a very high pH, which leads to the corrosion of the aluminium. Here you can see an aluminium foil from an aqueous processed cathode. And this is also accompanied by hydrogen evolution. And you can see this also on a coating line. Here you see two electrodes, aqueous coated electrodes, and you see here this very small gas bubbles. If the pH of the slurry is too high. On the other side. Also, the nickel-rich cathode active material is not inert in water. There is normally leaching and exchange between protons and lithium, which leads to lithium carbonate on the surface of the active material, to a deliciated subsurface layer, which leads to a quite an increase of impedance and also a loss of capacity. The lithium and transition metal leaching has been described in literature by many different groups. Normally, we have the formation of lithium and transition metal carbonates and hydroxide surface species and a drastic loss of capacity and performance. And this is increased by higher nickel content in the active material and can be decreased by addition of an acid and by adjusting the pH of the slurry at lower pHs. So here you see an example of an lithium nickel 0.83 nickel 811 immersed in water, and you can see here that the pH directly increases to a pH about 12, and this leads to a leaching out of lithium. And if you adjust the pH with an acid, you also have to be careful, for at lower pH, the lithium leaching is decreased, but the dissolution of transition metals from the active materials is increased. So there is the possibility to adjust the pH either by using binders like polyacrylic acid, which give a lower pH, or by addition of an acid. We used hydrofluoric acid as additive, studied different binders, and you can see here with optimizing the binder, it's possible to increase significantly the cycling life of NCM 811. Also for aqueous process. Here you see different binders with PAA. We always observed slightly lower specific capacity compared to SBR. CMC binders, and the rate capability and the cycling stability was increased by using a low amount of SBR and by adjusting the ratio between CMC and SBR, and you can see here that it's possible to get full cell measurements in pouch cells, that it's possible to get a relatively stable system also with aqueous processed NCM 811. And the question is, okay, maybe this is easy in a lab process where you can work very fast. But what happens if we are going to a pilot process with larger mixers in a 50, in this case we went to a 15 liter scale. Here the important parameters are the solid content of the of the slurry, the temperature, and also the steering time. To make it fast with higher water content, higher temperature, and also higher steering time, the lithium leaching is increased, and also after addition of the phosphoric acid, also the time has to be controlled for storage of the slurry. Going to a pilot coating unit, you can see here that with adjustment of all the parameters, it's possible to get exactly the same charge discharge curve for an aqueous-based process compared to an NMP-based process. The same is true for the rate capability. There is nearly no difference. And here you can see the cycling stability in full cells at room temperature and at higher temperature. We haven't reached exactly the same cycling stability, but it's possible to get more than 1500 cycles in a full cell with NMC 811, which is completely aqueous processed. And it's also possible to make 21700 cells from this electrodes with very reproducible performance, good rate capability, and also very high cycling stability. Now I will come to the conclusion. Also the mixing process or the slurry preparation has a significant influence on the mechanical and but also electrochemical properties of the electrodes. There are different structuring concepts to customize the microstructure of thicker electrodes, particle blend layers, or optimization of the passive material gradient. There are also other structuring concepts I have not mentioned today, for example, laser structuring of the electrodes or making a porosity gradient inside the electrodes. The methods are quite different. Some of them need additional processes, for example, laser structuring, but these methods can lead to a significant increase of power density for thick electrodes, and we think that this wet-in-wet coating using double layer slot die is a very promising process, and it's also possible to have an aqueous processing of nickel-rich active materials, layered oxides, which can be realized by adjusting the process parameters, adjusting the pH, and by proper selection of the binders and additives. This is a very promising route for better recyclability of batteries in the future. For I think in the future we really have to regain the active material from end of life batteries. At the end, I like to acknowledge all my cooperation partner who did the work, like Alice Hoffmann, Emanuel Haider, Lea Krämer, Andreas Albrecht, Herrn Thomas, Christian Trier, Thomas Meinecke, Sonja Radloff, Rarisch Skoto und Anton Fechter vom ZSW und die Modeling Groups from the University of Ulm, von Volker Schmidt, Anne Westhoff und Benedikt Briefling und Timo Danner von Hein und Arnulf Latz vom DLR and of course also the funding projects. Thank you very much for your attention.
Presentation.